So let's talk about our customer journey. So our customer journey is basically broken into a number of stages. So first question to ask is, how do our customers want to be reached? What channels do they prefer? But which channels are best for you? And it's not always the same thing. You have a preference. We've got a website and I do loads of, LinkedIn. But actually, is that where your customers are? Is that the channels that they want to do? You might be a real crack shot on Facebook, but if your customer base aren't there, then you might be investing a lot of time there. And it's always good to look at what the competition does, because if you can understand where the competition is on their preferred channels, then that will give you an indication about we should either be there or we should not be there. And you can gauge whether or not they're successful in their channel strategy by just simply looking at the sentiment that's on their channels. How much engagement do they get when they put a post on there? Does anybody like it? Does anybody share it? Does anybody, what kind of followers do they have? So let's look at the five stages of your channel strategy. And it's much more than just communications and distributions. The first one is raising awareness. So how are you going to tell people you've got this new, like the business is changing direction, or you've got a new service or a series of new products that you're bringing to market? So there's a whole awareness piece, the outreach that you might do through your, kind of contact list. It could be the social media channels that you use. It's a whole new brand refresh or changes to your website. There's a number of different ways you put the flag up the pole so people can see it. The second stage is evaluation. So great, all right, you've told me about it. How do I know it's any good? So the question then is, how do they try this thing, this brand new product, and how can they gain an understanding that this thing is worth them investing time or money in? Would you offer samples? Could they try before they bought it? Is there a time limited offer available? If this is something that this is going to be repeat business, would you be willing to subsidize the first instance of that service delivery so they can do an evaluation on how good it is to work with you before they then commit fully to it? And they might just come back and ask for more information. So is there information sheets? Are there case studies or examples of what good looks like, how people are using this thing already, or your best guess, your white paper you might have produced about it, or just something to evidence the fact that as part of their decision-making process, you thought this through and you provided them with an answer to it. So you'll go through that cycle a whole load of times, and unfortunately, it's hard work, and you have to put the miles in. Now, some automated sales funnels and sales outreach programs can actually take away a lot of that for you, because you set up processes for people to go through to make that happen. But if that's not your thing, then accept the fact that there'll be a lot of evaluation, but not everybody will convert. If they do convert, how easy is it for them to buy from you? So what is your sales order process? And remember, keeping it simple for the customer. Then the delivery model, who's delivering this thing? And again, remember, thinking you can either, if you're auditing your current state, think about who's involved, who is in the supply chain from the point that the order is placed to the point the customer receives it. How many links is there in that process? Who's talking to all of these links? Is it just me? Am I doing all of this? Or have I dedicated people within the organization to do it? But anyway, whether you're a sole trader or whether or not you're a large organization, the whole delivery model is one that deserves focus in its own right, because there are significant gains to be made there of reducing your costs, increasing, kind of the availability of products, getting them to people on time safely. That's stage four. And then, of course, hopefully that's it, isn't it? So long, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, goodbye. It's all done. Don't need to see you again. Thanks very much, but don't call us. And we won't call you. Or actually, is there a bit of after sales? So maybe as part of the offer, there has to be, because actually you give them this thing, but then there's a constant support that may be required, which they're either paying for as a secondary income stream, or it's all rolled into the overall price. But the other use for after sales really is just to gather opinion about how their customer experience was, how easy, this journey. Ask them all about this. How easy was it? Did you have any problems with the website? Did you, how was my colleague when they came to site? Things like that. You don't often want to hear the answer, because sometimes it creates opportunities for improvement where things are identified that aren't quite perfect. But that's not a problem. That's not a bad thing. There are worse things that you could do with your time. And of course, when you're on that conversation, then you can start talking to them about the next big thing, which is back to stage one, awareness of the next product or the next service that you're offering. So they're the five phases: raise awareness, put the flag up the pole, find a way that they can do an informed evaluation of it through recommendations, through trialing, through examples, through sharing information that will put their mind at rest and really put you in them into a state of buying. Make the purchase process as easy and seamless as possible. Make sure that they get it as quickly and safely as possible, and then stay with them if you think there's any value in that.